OSU researchers have uncovered new genetic markers that could be used to study aardvarks in sub-Saharan Africa.
Aardvarks are really difficult to study on the landscape. They are nocturnal, they're very secretive and shy, and they're solitary unless they're with their young.
We needed markers that would actually allow us to assess genetic variation even from that kind of degraded DNA.
Researchers analyzed a total of 253 fecal samples, including 104 for genetic information. This revealed that growing aridification was isolating aardvark populations, possibly threatening their long-term survival.
It feels like quite the Easter egg hunt. You have to first find out where there are aardvarks on the landscape, and then they've been moving around often, and they're digging up termites, they're digging up ants. So you have to follow their tracks, find their digging, and then scrape through all the loose dirt to try to find the droppings.
Clinton Epps is a wildlife research biologist with Oregon State University. He has been researching aardvarks since 2016.
When I first started working in East Africa many years ago, I learned aardvark tracks very early because it's a very distinctive look to them. They've got long ears, they've got excellent hearing, they've got long snout and a long tongue that they can use to slurp up their ant and termite prey.
Also known as the earth pig, an aardvark is an 88 to 188 pound mammal, best known for their long snout used for sniffing out ants and termites. An aardvark's sticky tongue can measure up to a foot long, giving them great reach to grasp their prey.
A lot of climate change model predictions have shown there will be less precipitation, leading to drier areas. And because these animals are so dependent on ants and termites, which in turn are dependent on moisture, they hypothesize that increased aridification is really going to have an impact on aardvarks as a species.
Rachel Crowhurst, a senior faculty research assistant, has collaborated with Epps since 2008.
Aardvarks are considered keystone species in the ecosystems that they inhabit. What this means is that the impact that they have on the environment is proportionately a lot larger than what you would expect based on their biomass there. The way that we usually see this is through these enormous burrows that they use for shade and for thermoregulation during the daytime. They use them for predator avoidance and also to raise their young.
Aardvarks often move 3 miles during a night to feed and burrow. These 10-foot deep burrows provide shelter for animals like the warthog and the mongoose after being abandoned by the aardvark.
A lot of the animals that have gotten a lot of research focus in Africa were game animals. You know, elephants, buffalo, giraffe. So they were animals that were active during the day and they were pursued by hunters and then they became of interest to conservationists. So here you've got an animal that people don't even often know where they are on the landscape. If you actually want to see one, you're going to have to cover a lot of ground at night.
In 2015, the International Union of Conservation of Nature, or IUCN, listed the aardvark as least concern on their list of threatened species.
Just because something is globally considered of least concern doesn't mean that there aren't conservation-related questions and issues, particularly locally. You know, you might have them doing very badly in an entire country or an entire region, even if globally there's plenty of them.
I hope in general that this study brings more awareness to aardvark on a basic level. We're missing so much baseline information about population abundance and distribution across the landscape and survival of these animals from year to year. I would actually love to see some citizen science incorporated into this, where we could train people across the range of the aardvark how to identify sign and start to report where they're seeing them and maybe where they used to see them and they aren't anymore.
Future research will involve expanded efforts to study aardvark DNA samples from different regions across sub-Saharan Africa.
A lot of times we're doing research where we're working on species and questions that have been examined before, but now and again you get the opportunity to work on something that is really new. And nobody has ever looked at the genetic differences of aardvarks in the wild.